I'm very happy to be here. My name is Dirk Riehle. I'm a professor of computer science at a German engineering university, but I have lived and worked in the area for 10 years. Left the Silicon Valley Bay Area about 5 years ago, and I'm very happy to come by and come back here as often as possible. This is actually my second talk, I believe, for the SF Bay Area ACM chapter, but I was also told this is the first time we're doing it at Symantec here, and so I hope you'll bear with me that this is actually the first time I'm doing this talk as part of a major reorganization of my open source talks. And so I want to provide a little bit context. This talk is about how open source project communities work and how volunteering works. So how you, what stages you can take and how volunteers and project leaders work with each other to fulfill the mission of a project. But open source is really much, much broader, and I don't think it's widely understood how broad open source has become. Sure, everyone's using it, but I believe it's really changing the industry. So when you're talking about open source, you have the basic stuff. Everyone needs to understand IP, what the licenses mean. The next step is to understand what I'm talking about today. How do these collaborative, volunteer-based communities work? That's surprising that people spend time for free. The engineering processes in open source can be very different from your traditional corporate software engineering process. But there is no single open source software engineering process. It differs or varies by project. So this is one thing to think about. If you're a product company, I'm sure you have some sort of open source governance, making sure that no wrong open source, meaning no open source of the improper license from your strategic perspective, makes it into your product. How do you ensure that? How do you train your developers? How do you deal with the supply chain of third-party components, open source or not, that make it into your product so that you have no undesired effect? These are the basics, if you will. But the interesting thing then is how in the next step, open source is really being developed beyond the traditional volunteer projects that we'll be talking about today. So you are all aware of open source foundations, Linux Foundation, Eclipse, etc. These are software developer companies coming together. Linux Foundation against Windows, Eclipse against Visual Studio, OpenStack against Amazon, kind of an industry shaping event to keep basically typically some 800-pound gorilla in check. So we have some idea of how the governance and structure and processes of these developer organizations work to achieve the strategic goals of the companies who found them. But open source doesn't stop there. In newer development are user foundations, where the founding parties are not software development companies, product firms, but the users of the software who basically team up to have the software developed that is of interest to them. So in Germany, where I now live, for example, I have initiated a consortium of energy companies, not software companies, energy companies who, as part of the major changes in the energy systems of Germany, are working to get better software for the smart grid. And they want it to be open source, to have no vendor lock-in, to make sure that innovation can develop as fast as possible, etc. You have the business models of how you actually can make money, a lot of money, with open source, where I distinguish between the distributor firms, Red Hat, SUSE, where the IP that they actually make money off is in the test suites, the compatibility information, the databases, etc., and it's not the software itself, which is open source. And then the almost classic by now, think MySQL, single vendor open source firms where a company goes to market with an open source strategy but keeps a very tight control of the IP behind the project. And finally, the last subject here is open source labor economics, which is of course a fancy academic term for having a career in open source. What does it mean to be an open source developer? Which is actually having significant impact on the potential career path of software developers, as we'll see actually in a little bit as well. So these are different topics that make up open source in its full breadth. I'm showing this to illustrate how project communities, my topic tonight, fits in there. And also would love to hear, because I'm sure there are many experts among you, love to hear from you what you think might be missing, because everyone has some particular perspective on open source. So please also let me know if you'd like to see something added here. So working towards our topic tonight, project communities, are the five stages of open source volunteering. The first step, most of you probably have taken that, is to realize that open source is not just about the licenses. It's not the copyleft license or permissive license only. That's an important part of open source. But open source has a second part of its definition, which is that it's a particular process of collaboration, an open process of collaboration. And if you go to the website of the open source initiative, then you'll find this additional definition that open source is a development process of particular qualities. This is straightforward, taken from the website, with some promises like better quality, higher reliability, etc., etc., and of course, an end to vendor lock-in. We'll see how that plays out as well. And still a bit more context, because it otherwise might be confusing where I'm talking, what type of projects I'm talking about. This is how I see the open source world. I see five quite different types of projects, if you will. Each band here is a timeline of this one particular type of project. There's the original volunteer open source. People coming together to develop software for fun and profit. The original Linux project, of course, the GNU software before that, various software that I call it traditional if it does not have an organization behind it. Actually, in response to Linux becoming valuable, immediately a business model followed the distributor model, so making it easy for customers to get control over a zoo of thousands of components by getting one nice package, the distribution. So this is a business model and companies supporting it. The really important development in terms of professionalization of open source was the establishment of these developer foundations, where companies realized the economic value of open source and decided we need to put those economically important projects like the HTTPD, the Apache web server, onto more solid grounds, created nonprofit organizations where the work was sponsored by the companies. These are open source developer foundations. This is community open source, meaning there's a community of developers where no single entity, no particular company has a say on how it has to be done. It is a collaborative process with no single particular entity in power. Yes, there is now a nonprofit organization, but the nonprofit organization has a governance in place that makes it a fair, mostly fair and square evolution of these projects and how specifically we'll come to. There was another evolution straight out of Silicon Valley, even though the company I list here, MySQL, was a Finnish one, the single vendor open source as a go-to-market strategy. And the new one, and so again, here, commercial interest, and the new one, the Open Source User Foundation, software users who have open source software developed. So I want to talk not about the two gray bands here, commercial projects, where the commercial owner of the software is keeping IP under control, but I want to talk about the real community open source projects with a broad array of stakeholders, all of which, by way of fair governance, can actively and openly participate. So in this simple 2x2 matrix, you can see here on the left, community open source projects like the Linux kernel, like the Apache web server, or a distribution like Debian, and the commercial ones I will not be addressing today. The commercial ones are important topics. I care very deeply about commercial open source and open source business models, but it's and how to do it right. It's just not my topic tonight. So community open source is open source software, a project owned and managed by a company, by a community, and it follows certain principles, which we call the open collaboration principles, that will come back to us in a couple of slides. I have one research slide because I really like it, because it's still eye-opening sometimes to see how much of the open source work, community or not, is paid for by companies. So what you can see here is a simple graph from one of our research papers. Each line is a day in the week, and you can see the hours of the day. It's been normalized, so time zones have been adjusted, etc. And you can see how the solid lines are Monday through Friday, and this is the weekend, how much activity is going on. So you can see a regular person stay here, almost. So yes, people do sleep at night. Work picks up. There's something of a dip around noon. Work keeps going on and around for dinner. Work goes down again. There's a blip after dinner, which is perhaps unusual, but maybe, since we know our industry, not that unusual. The key thing to observe is, wait a second, this is Monday to Friday, 9 to 5, where the bulk of the work is being done. This is not all volunteers or on the weekend. This is people paid for by companies. And as we looked at the projects they're contributing to community projects, infrastructure projects, work which benefits even their competitor as IBM, SAP, and Oracle managed to collaborate under the guidance of the Apache Software Foundation. So open source is solidly commercially supported. The companies pay for the development of the software. Maybe not a big novel thing to say here in the Silicon Valley, but still relevant for many other contexts. So let me focus now on what career path and then also what volunteering steps people take, what best practices apply to them as you want to build a community, for example. I call it a career path. Maybe that is a very traditional word, but it actually is quite relevant to view the engagement of a person in an open source project as a career you are having in open source, orthogonal to your possible corporate career. It really is an orthogonal dimension. So someone might start out just using the software. They make a contribution, like a bug report or submit a patch, they become a contributor. They work long enough, and that's what we'll be talking about today, they might become a committer, someone who has commit rights, write rights to the code repository, and thereby typically becomes a member of the core team of a project. This is the traditional career path where someone who just stumbles on a project might end up contributing, might end up leading a project. It actually is only half of the story because of the establishment of the open source foundations to manage the development and roadmap and architecture of whole industry platforms. That's what the Apache Software Foundation provides, the Eclipse Software Foundation, the Eclipse Foundation provides. These are major industry platforms. You can have a career inside these foundations by way of the roles they give you, which would be member of a project management committee. That's the common name. Names vary a bit from between foundations, where you help steer architecture roadmap of key open source components of economic relevance. You might become the leader of such a committee, obviously be performing even more important work. You might become a member of the foundation as a person. That's possible in the ASF, for example, where you are guiding the development really of the foundation as a host for industry platforms. Now, this second part is important to understand because it establishes these careers we see, But today I will focus on project communities where you are a volunteer, where you're not right away paid for. Here, nobody in any of these positions is not typical. Okay, so 95% of all people in positions like this are paid by the company to do that job. And actually, if they go to another company, if it's a proper foundation, they will take this position with them, which makes them economically valuable to new employers. But they will certainly insist that they keep being paid for the work in the context of these open source foundations. So this is all paid for work. They may love it, and they may have started out as volunteers, but it's clearly by now paid for work. I want to talk about the unpaid work, where you are a volunteer coming towards a project and having going through stages of engagement. These are the five stages, how we call them, of open source volunteering. It's basically, and that's quite important, a dual view. There's a volunteer view, someone who has a need, like solve a problem by way of an open source component. And there's the project, which is always looking for more people to help the project. So these two interests need to meet each other. They need to match. Otherwise, there's no volunteering, no help for the project, and no problem solving for the person looking to solve that problem. And it's pretty straightforward. A volunteer has an issue, tries to find a project, find something, maybe it's the right thing, maybe not, needs to understand the project. If it looks reasonable, will want to engage with the project. If it's really good and fun, they'll continue working. And in some cases, certainly not always, but sometimes might even end up being sucked in so far that they become a part of the core team, become a leader of the project as well. This needs to be matched by, as I said, the project view. To find a project, the project needs to be findable. So there's marketing that needs to be done. To understand a project, there needs to be someone who explains it so people don't give up in exasperation. So the project needs to be presented, understandable. Behind all of these, there are patterns, practices of how to do it right, which is what most of this talk is about. And if someone engages with the project, is new, well, who stops them from just walking right away because it's such an annoying thing? No, the project needs to know how to welcome newbies, how to work with them, how to make sure that they don't walk away, at least those that you want to keep. The project needs to know how to work with volunteers, and ultimately, here these two sides merge again. The leaders need to enable some sort of career or benefit for people inside the project to make sure they are in there for the long term. So again, I'm focusing on the colorful part here of traditional open source projects where you first, you find it, you become a user, you become a contributor, you become a committer, a member of the core team, and I omit the foundational open source for now. We are not the only ones to have worked on it. There are various models who explain this in different forms. We say it's five stages. There's also the onion model, which is a bit more specific, simply has more rings. There's Brian Behlendorf, who had this project immigration model, which is a nice illustration of how and why people come to open source projects, because they have an itch to scratch, as the saying goes. But Behlendorf already makes clear, well, you need to really distinguish between users and developers. It's different kinds of contributions, and I'll come to that as well. Let us simplify this as five stages, and the way I want to talk about them is by way of best practices. So that's what my research group typically does. We want to understand something, build a theory, if you will. That's the academic lingo, but we also always want to cast it in practical terms. So that theory needs to be expressed as a handbook of best practices, how to do X. A best practice is welcome a newbie to the community. So don't just be quiet. There's a new person, just say hello and welcome them. That's a very basic pattern, if you will, or best practice, but it needs to be understood. If you want to gain volunteers, you say hi, and like our friendly welcoming greeting person Greg, who welcomed each of us as we walked in here. So in the following, I will basically provide lots of these best practices. I will provide them by that title only. We'll see, we see it like this. Behind each of these bullet items, which is the title of a best practice, you can have a whole page of elaboration what that actually means. In the beginning, they are really simple because we are now at stage one. The volunteer has some problem, thinks maybe software and open source component can solve it. And so very basic would be go search on an open source portal for some software that solves your problem. So it's this command style of how you would name a best practice and then explain how you do it. So a volunteer, so some person, not yet a volunteer, who wants to find something, there are two ways to it. You just stumble by lucky chance on it, or you actually explicitly search for it, different practices of how to do it, which needs to be matched by the project or some project leaders working for the project so that people can stumble on your project. People will find your project as they search for something. I don't know whether you've had this experience. You're searching for something. You don't even necessarily know the right keywords to find exactly what you're looking for. As you learn over time, you would know the right keywords, but it just takes time to go there. So there's a couple of simple best practices that I'm listing here, like a project should have a good name, obviously. But as you might start a project or have started a project, you just need to be reminded, be clear, yes, it should be a precise name rather than some elaborate wording that's an insider's joke that nobody understands. By the way, so these best practices that I'll be listing here are not just my best practices or my team's. This is a lot of literature. Typically, I have a literature reference here. I'll be happy to provide the slides for anyone interested. So in that reference, then you will find somewhere a more elaborate description of basically just the shorthand that I'm giving you here. So back to marketing a project. That's the active outreach. You're marketing the project. So for that, your project needs to have a good name. You need to understand the channels by which you reach your audience. You need to use them consistently. You need to make your announcements very clear, very visible. You should be matter of fact, as one author calls it, meaning no hyperbole, don't overdo it. Just be building a solid reputation by knowing how to talk to those people, developers maybe, who will talk like you. So say, be matter of fact. Here are some examples of how you could do that. Conferences. Well, you want to be present at conferences, or maybe if you're as large as the, well, or as well known at least as the Apache Software Foundation, you even have your own conference. Mailing lists is very traditional way, Twitter a bit more recent, Facebook, what have you, all the social media channels. You need to use them. You need to get your name on those channels. Straightforward, very simple so far, but bear with me. The other thing is what I call here passive inflow. Now you're not really marketing, you just want to be found by someone who comes searching. So you need to be present on all relevant places. What that means comes in a second. You need to literally think like a search engine optimizer. You want to be found. You need to have the right keywords, right metadata, etc. You register on open source portals, you think about the first impression you're leaving, what summary, what key information needs to be provided, etc. This is actually already a little bit, this is all fortunately now not trivial any longer, because maybe the most important portal of sorts is the former OLO, now OpenHub, a place where you can go and learn about open source projects. It was actually designed to show you metrics on open source projects to help development leads, engineering managers make informed decision about is this component better than the other, etc. But it's actually become a place where developers register themselves, where projects register themselves, and feed the information to give an accurate picture and can be found. These portals sadly don't work that well. So there's free code, which used to be fresh meat. These pure indexes like Yahoo are not really, are still around, but are not working too well. It's tools that provide metrics that are automated to a large extent, like OpenHub, that work well. But certainly something basic like you absolutely need to have your own own homepage. All right, so open source is just software development on one level, and they didn't really invent any new tools except for one. And they didn't invent bug trackers or code repositories, or version control, I mean. But they did invent software forges. A software forge like GitHub or SourceForge is a web-based tool for collaborative software development where for a project you get all the tools you need. And so they just put the tools together that you would need for a project, but then not just for one project, but for any number. So on a software forge like SourceForge or GitHub, you can have a large number of projects. And the innovation that open source actually brought us, again, is not bug trackers and version control, but it is that the software forge is a place where projects present themselves and where the forge works towards matching seekers, possible volunteers with projects. So you look at a software forge and you wonder what's new here, and you realize it's the way of how visitors are guided to help them find a solution to their problem on the one side, as well as on the other side, help projects find volunteers. So this stumbling and searching that I talk about is well supported by these forges, by various features. For example, we're looking at SourceForge here. You go to SourceForge, it's about finding projects right away. You go to the homepage, you type in your keywords. All projects on SourceForge are indexed with the keywords. So you can find, you're looking for an Android native something app. You type in your keywords, and on that forge, it will be found. But it's not just the obvious search functionality. It's hierarchical browsing. All projects get classified, so you can browse a hierarchy and look what's there, what are alternative offerings. There's the stumbling part. Simply by lucky chance, the recommendations, the project of the month. Well, next month it's a different one, so you don't see this one any longer. But the visitor just sees one interesting thing. 90% will not care, but 10% for them it was the lucky chance. So that's an interesting project to look at. The front page is structured for bringing projects, your project, into the eyes of a searcher. SourceForge, well, GitHub is, I guess that's fair to say, doing much better. Same thing with GitHub. Not on the GitHub homepage where they're trying to sell GitHub Enterprise, of course, but when you go to explore, all the features that help you find that open source project that you might be looking for, keyword based search, hierarchical browsing, trending repositories, active projects, so repository here project, etc. These forges are made to make the match between volunteer and project happen. Okay, stage two, a volunteer finds something by way of any of these mechanisms and wants to understand it. So the volunteer should just read up rather than say ask silly questions without having read anything. The interesting thing is, what does a project do? The project expects hopefully many visitors, doesn't want to explain for each visitor individually what it is about, so rather wants to have a homepage or something where all of it is nicely laid out so that it's easy, doesn't create extra work, the extra visitor to learn what the project is about. Again, from the literature, our own work, you should have a clear mission statement. A single sentence, put there what your project is about. Don't forget this. It's sometimes basic, yes, but you really need to do it. So have a mission statement, give a visual impression by way of examples and screenshots for open source. Actually, by now I somehow think less important. At least I observe that what used to be good advice 10 years ago always have the license out there right away. I don't see it that often smack in your face. Way too often I have to dig for the open source license. So some of these practices may have changed over time. Make it easy to download the software, to install it, to try it out. Show what to expect. Is this stable or is it in active development or is it just an early prototype? So manage expectations of anyone who comes by, state your rules of engagement, etc. So SoftwareForge also supports that. So here is a project called WinPython, and it gives you shows you as the developer, and you can download it, gives you screenshots, and it's an unfortunate side effect of mobile first that all the information is actually down here. So it's hard to have a wide screen, but actually the content is like this. So all what I just talked about will follow on the screen down here. It's the information that users are looking for, so the homepage should quickly provide it. Now then, some volunteer read up on the project because you made it easy. They understand what it is about and think that might solve the problem. So maybe they download the software and try it. So we are now, maybe they then go away. But on the other hand, maybe there's an issue with using the software. And so we now want to talk about stage three, engaging with the project. So coming out of the shadows, not being a lurker any longer, how do you engage? And this is, of course, where it gets critical, because now the anonymous user might become a volunteer, or at least they're interested in communicating with the project. So on the volunteer side, it's somewhat simple. If you have a question, know how to ask the question. In particular, search first. If it's a widely used project, Stack Overflow may have the answer. So don't make a fool out of yourself by asking two simple, obvious questions. So search archives of projects or search the web, read documentation. If you want to engage, if you want to communicate, again, be matter of fact, etc. Is there a question? Yes, please.
Yes, it's a good question. So a lot of open source projects started from universities, CMU Berkeley, Linux started from university in Europe. And then there are commercial projects like Java that started from the Sun. And then there, I suppose there are also like other types of open sources started maybe from other individuals. Do you see different characteristics of these, you know, different kinds of open source projects?
Yes, these projects can be very different. The answer to that was actually, to your question, is these first slides that I presented where I classified the projects into, in my opinion, five different projects. The traditional volunteer, which may not have much of an economic impact, so it never got professionalized in the sense that it became part of a software foundation. If it was economically important, then it typically becomes part of a software foundation, which may be a developer foundation, so it's typically competitively not differentiating software where companies can work together. That's one version, and the other is the user foundations, where it's the users. And then you mentioned Java, then there's commercial open source, yet another tack at it. I'm talking about those where the software is being developed not primarily for commercial purposes, at least not for immediate revenue. Of course, there's, by building on top of it, revenue to be gained. I'm talking about what I call true community open source. So we are talking now about people wanting to engage. From the volunteer side, it just means be a decent and smart human being, so communicate prudently. And if you're a developer, look at the practices as laid out and spelled out and follow those. The most common, I hope this is over now, but the most common misconception is that if there's an open source project that makes an offer to you, that somehow they are required to help you. Of course, they are not. An open source project is primarily there to help itself or help those people who are developing it, there's no right of yours to get an answer, which is exactly why you should be honest and humble as you ask a question. There's enough of motivation to help you, but not necessarily without any selfishness, because people see benefit in good questions and answers and possibly gaining contributors. So no, the community does not exist to serve you. You need to be smart. Here's an example of how to write a good email to introduce yourself, to ask a first question. You can see how this person is very well aware of what it's doing by qualifying, providing context. It's the first time they are asking. So it's a little bit like asking for forgiveness if they make some blooper, but then there's a very clear matter of fact, here's what I want, here's what I did, and these are the problems I ran into. Clear-cut developer communication, humble, to the point, technical. This guy certainly actually got an answer. This is how to approach a community. Some basic pattern. This is how you should go if you have a question on a project you're using. Okay, so how should the project now react? So there's someone unheard of so far who made a contribution, who has a problem at hand. Well, that is the signal that this person is possibly going to buy into this project. I mean, they have an interest, they want to solve a problem. Maybe they're a future volunteer. So you certainly want to slowly, or at least deliberately, engage with that person. You want to get to know them a little bit and maybe reel them in. But first of all, to make such a conversation happen in the first place, again, basic practices, simply explain how people can ask questions. By now, there's so much common knowledge, if you will, because it's so ingrained. Yes, there's a forum and a mailing list, and that's where you ask, okay. But maybe there are other channels. Maybe one particular project uses IRC or something. So in any case, you need to make explicit how you want questions to be asked. Anyone who shows up, you should welcome them in discussions with, in particular, people who are, say, new to the community, in some sense may feel vulnerable. Some people are in your face, they have no problem sending emails to mailing lists. Other people are shy, and if you just talk rudely to them, they'll go away. Maybe you don't want that. So certainly stop or prevent any rudeness in communication, etc. Okay. There's more, which I'll come to in a bit as well. If you really want to reel someone in, you need to lay out bait, is the wrong word. Provide simple tasks. Simply leave out in the open simple things that can be done to help the project, which you probably could easily do yourself if you're a project leader, but you don't want to. You want someone else to pick it up, do it, feel good about it, get positive feedback, buy into the project. So simple best practices here from our best practices handbook. As you might engage not just with a user, but with a developer, you need to show them the tools. You shouldn't hide them. That's the other thing about software forges. It's all out in the open. Having worked here at SAP in the Silicon Valley in 2006, I was part of a team that introduced an internal software forge within the company. That was unheard of, somewhat, that all the source code, all the project artifacts would be visible across the company. Way too many companies have their silos and a need to know base to show their projects, so nobody ever knows what the other silo or the other group is doing. And open source, of course, that kills you. No, you want to be found, you want to be seen. So again, the software forge makes it easy for you to present yourself. And that's not just providing information for consumption. That, of course, certainly also applies to the main artifacts, the code, as well as all other artifacts, as well as the tools to work on them. You want the tools to be open and visible, and people should be able typically to contribute. Not necessarily to the source code. Usually you have this two-tier hierarchy where the committer is a reviewer of any code that goes into the code repository. But why not open mailing lists and forums and bug tracker for the public? Well, there's no point in preventing the public from filing a bug report. So you open your tools, you show where you are, the project artifacts people can read up on and possibly make a contribution. So after we worked a while on what could all these best practices be and classifying them, etc., we ran across a couple of more basic principles that I want to communicate behind these. And one of them is the principle of open communication and coordination. So how do people talk with each other? And we believe, or it's pretty obvious, I think, that these are the four criteria or characteristics. Any communication in an open source project, unless there are exceptional circumstances, should be public, written, complete, and archived. And if you've never participated in an open source project, you'll know this is very different from your company, or may be very different from your company, where people A, like to pick up the phone, that's not written, that's not archived, and talk it through with one other person, and not necessarily all possible stakeholders. So this is quite different from how you typically communicate in companies, and it has desirable effects to make the project better and more sustainable. And that happens because public communication in the first place creates more trust. There's nothing hidden going on. It's all out there in the open and you can read up on it. It also disciplines people to be more matter of fact, to be talking about the issue at hand rather than about people or politics, etc. So it's visible, it creates trust, it doesn't exclude anyone a priori. And obviously do this with the relevant tools. Then why should it be written? Well, it should be written because it really increases the reach of the communication. There may be people in other time zones, in other locations. They wouldn't be able to participate in a discussion in front of a whiteboard. So, because you put it in writing on a mailing list, everyone can see it. That's how open source made it possible that you had broadly distributed, still reasonably effective software development. You put it in writing, you make it clearer, you make it understandable, everyone can see it. Also, it has the second order effect that it's easy to archive. And again, so here's a nice saying, I think that's Fogel. If it wasn't written down, it might as well not exist. So it's really that open source project dislike it if people talk too much on the side and don't do it in a public written form. Well, I'm not sure I'd go into too much detail here. Email communication needs to be effective. So have one purpose. This is actually almost independent of open source, and there's good advice on how to write good emails. So it should be complete so that nothing is omitted, so that at the end of a discussion, you can have a good summary and see how the conclusion, where it comes from. And that also creates more trust. You need to imagine an open source discussion on a design issue within a project, for example, that is can be a lengthy discussion. You don't want to exclude anyone. It's typically focused on the merits. That's very good. And at the end, you write that summary email that displays or summarizes the consensus gained. We are going to design it this way. Here are the pros, here are the cons, and that's why we decided this way. And that then gets archived because you have everything automatically archived. That's part of it. And that has the benefit that open source projects, if you will, are almost self-documenting. It's not perfect documentation to have everything in email, but with email discipline, this form of communication and mailing list archives, you get much better documentation than if you either had none or you were forcing people who don't want to do it to write something into some document somewhere after the fact, which will be only a subset of what needs to be said, doesn't have the rationale of how you got to any conclusion, etc., etc. So public, written, complete, and archived communication. Yes, so once again, learning how to communicate is really important. Companies even have training programs for employees they send to contribute in open source projects such that the engagement and communication does not hurt the company, because things that may be appropriate inside a company, maybe not American companies, but let's say a German company, people sometimes will curse or something like that. You should do this on a public mailing list, obviously. So, and there's much more to be said. Okay. What motivates volunteers? So we are now in this engagement phase. This is this critical step. They came out, they asked the question, you're establishing a dialogue. You want to know, is this a good person to have in the project? Do we need to invest more? Should we be perhaps more hands-off, etc.? Here are the typical motivations. People come, they have a problem, they want to solve it. Some simply like to stretch the muscles. Some literally want to show, want to build a public portfolio of their work in order to be more easily hireable. We can measure that, that's actually true. And sometimes they just want to have fun, so that's the social motivation of doing good and working in a good team or in a community. So in order to go from some first question that someone asks to a contribution, you have these simple tasks that are out there. You really want to make that first contribution easy. And you want to make it incremental, so not a major thing. That's certainly true for software development. We clearly know from the data that if you want to make a contribution as a software developer to an open source project, chunk it up. Make it small patch submissions. Small patch submissions are understood. Don't pose a risk to the project, and the people where you submit them to, the committers, will feel good after review of letting it in. If you dump a large amount of code onto a project, it's most likely not to get, not going to get integrated. All right. So, and again, software forgers support this with various features like installable downloads that you can provide in prominent places, etc. GitHub is good like this. You go to GitHub, it prominently shows you, oh no, here's not the new pull request, but usually like fork this project, which is the first step on GitHub to start contributing. You fork the project, you make your changes, you send back, you send the original project pull request. It's in your face. You may think it's just there to get work done, but yes, it's exactly the work you want to see done in an open source project where it's easy for anyone to contribute if they want to, if they feel valued, if they were welcome, if the response to their first email was reasonable and helpful. Stage four, working as a volunteer working with the project or as a project leader working with a volunteer. The volunteer side, again, is simple. You should just be a reasonable person. So answer emails, be reasonably reliable, and actually make some contributions. On the project side, it gets a bit more complicated. Now you need to chunk up. For example, software architecture meets the project structure and social circumstances. Open source projects tend to be component oriented, so that people can work in their particular area and don't step on the toes of someone working on another component. That plays well to open source, which from the get-go was distributed. You never knew where the person was sitting who was coming to possibly contribute. And it happens to be very different from what we do in companies, or what even I teach my students, which is agile methods, which are typically feature-oriented. You cross across, you go across all tiers, you go across all components, but that really doesn't work well in this distributed fashion that open source, at least initially, set up its software architecture. The reason why agile and agile methods, feature orientation, nowadays works reasonably well with open source is because the place where you would use Scrum agile methods strongly in these open source foundations are all paid for developers who both know who know both sides of it, who know how to do Scrum or agile methods, as well as can organize and spend the whole day on synchronizing, organizing, working with other people. Yeah, so the advice here, again, these lists are never complete. These are just the top picks from the list of best practices, the famous no discussions in the bug tracker, just know how to use your tools, and you need to manage that.
Could you expand on that a little bit?
Because no discussions in the bug tracker?
I work for encourage discussions of features and bugs in the bug tracking system, but it sounds like you're saying don't do that.
Yeah, so now this is a very particular issue. According to here, this is actually taken straight from Fogel. They believe that you should not have, say, a design discussion in the bug tracker, but rather on the mailing list. The reason is that the mailing list more broadly reaches the people who might have to be involved while a particular issue has been assigned to some person, and so it doesn't get the breadth of visibility that you would want it to. You can, of course, have some discussions specifically around the issue at hand in the bug tracker, but as soon as it gets broader, that's at least the advice here, you should transfer it to a mailing list or more general communication form. All right, so yes, so there is this person, you help them a little bit, and maybe or hopefully now they actually submitted a patch, meaning they were trying to make a code contribution, so obviously react speedily to it. If you want it, show it that you like it. Show it that you value it by reacting to it, how you react to it, and that you react speedily. This can be much harder if you're doing a good project and you get a continuous stream of patches. You might easily be overloaded, so there are various ways of how people work on their patch queues. They might directly distribute it, allocate it to people. They may have their round robin working off the patch queue. They do their hackathons, etc., etc. As people contribute, they might not do it well. They might have hacked something and they used their favorite way of formatting their curly braces. And it's exactly the way how the project does not do it. What do you do in such a situation? The answer is you need to work with the person. You cannot let the quality of your project degrade. You have a vested, as a project leader, you have a vested interest. You want the quality to be as high as possible. Now, that person which makes or is trying to make a contribution needs to understand that. So you need to communicate in a non-confrontational way what you want from them. You cannot accept bad code. So you need to teach them, wonderful, well done, but could you please A, do it according to our programming guideline, and B, by the way, I think you're not covering corner case X here, so that looks like a bug. Could you please fix it? All right, so much more like this. As you have people starting to become more regular contributors, you should perhaps think as a project leader, you should be thinking about it almost like a manager. You want to develop people. So how can you help them stay with the project? Well, you need to understand their interests. So play to their interests. Maybe ask them, can you do this? Can you do that? There's a market shift in people as they build more loyalty with a project from doing what's fun for them, what's for their immediate benefit and need, their own itch that they're scratching, a shift to being loyal to the project as such, where they also would pick up work that simply helps the project, like unwanted task, less wanted task, like documentation or just something that's important, but that's just not fun for them or most other people to do, simply because they value the project itself. This is an effect that we've seen over and over again. It's a maturation of the buy-in and the loyalty to the project. And a project leader can support that by having an understanding where people are in this process and pushing or asking for work of that kind that might match that stage of the person and its growing loyalty to the project. All right, so ask people to do certain things, ask them nicely, of course. Try to share work, so certainly don't micromanage. Follow up, see how reliable a person is. So don't, someone says they want to do, they're willing to do something, you need to follow up if they're not doing it. Because other, you can't let it slide in some sense, and that's also a test of whether you want to keep that person around, etc. So we are now in a situation where we are effectively collaborating. It's not just simple questions and answers, we are now collaborating. Yes, please.
Well, I was wondering how many of the, those things are supported well by the tools now in terms of the past?
So most of these practices we have here are between people, and a lot of the communication is being done by email. So to the extent that you feel email is a good communication tool, which in many ways it's not, I guess, but it's very versatile, it's supported. From those here, the reality of open source is the tooling is actually pretty basic most of the times, usually not nearly as advanced as you might have it inside a company. And that is because, you know, it's hard to get a consensus on specifically a particular development environment or a particular tool set. So open source works surprisingly well with surprisingly basic tools. Let's put it that way. So you will not find IBM software architecture in open source software projects a lot. So then, now we are in this collaboration mode, and again, I would like to go back from just a set of practices to a more fundamental principles which we found here, which is what the principles we believe underlying open collaboration. This is what the Apache Software Foundation calls meritocracy, or the meritocratic way of building software. We thought that this is actually the term is being used too broadly, or we think it's these three more specific terms that more accurately capture what makes an open source project work and also how it's different from companies. So let me do it by comparison with how work in companies can be or often is very different from open source and what makes open source work. So in a company, you have your classic hierarchy, which leads to silos. You're assigned to a project. In open source, if you're a volunteer, you self-select. You go where you want to work. And as a consequence, that's what people want. So you need to be open for contribution. So you're not hiding yourself in a silo, but you do all the things that are already described. Be visible. Have a marketing mindset, be welcoming, don't hide. Decisions inside companies are ideally made after an informed discussion, but if push comes to shove, it's simply made by status. The software architect, the CTO decides, that's how we do it. If you do that in open source, If you're the project leader and you come down with the hammer and say, this is how we're going to do it, and it's not following up on a reasonable, consensus-oriented discussion, then you'll simply be losing people. You want the discussion to clearly have led to a consensus where people understand why you make a decision. Doesn't mean you can't sometimes have controversial decisions, but you clearly want that people understand their input has been valued, and it's not just status that decides. It doesn't matter whether you're new or old, if your argument is reasonable, you will have been heard, and that's good, and that's the meritocratic decision process. Decisions are based made on the merits of the arguments. in companies, understandably, but not necessarily a great thing, people want, or your manager wants you to be replaceable, doesn't want to depend too much on a particular person. In open source, you're typically happy if a new person, competent person comes around. And open source projects, and we see this over and over again, are willing to adjust the process to the people. Not randomly, and they're clearly best practices, and you're not going to do anything that's stupid and that will harm the project. But if you have a particular person which has particular strength, you will actually be willing to adjust your process to bring out the strength and capabilities of that project if it's in line with the project mission. While in the case of a company, you have that pre-described process, and you have a, in the worst case, you have a process definition department that uses some non-functioning workflow tool or something that asks you to follow certain steps, etc. So open source adjusts to the people, while in companies, in the extreme case, people clearly adjust to the company and its processes. So these are the basic principles, which then in the application that we see, which then in the application lead to this set of best practices. Consensus is really important. You sometimes hear about how projects are voting. This really is the last resort. It's sometimes painful, but discussions are carried out to their end so that based on the merits of the discussion and the arguments, you make the right discussion. Voting is really the last resort, and it might be indicative of some problem in the community. But in any case, always public, written, archived communication. This is just an illustration to show you what a project leader is up against. Numbers in relation, it's like a factor of 100 or sometimes more, from one project leader to 100 contributors to so many users. So then, if there's so many users, this is why I'm leading with this, how are you going to cope with a potential, if you have a successful project, onslaught of emails? So this is perhaps the best advice in total for project leaders, again from Fogel, the book Producing Open Source. View recruiting as an investment. So there's someone asking a question, they're doing it right, they seem reasonable. It's your time still. Think about, do you want to help that person? How much do you want to help this person? It must be a give and take where you're opening up and where you're seeing this person would be a good addition to the project. Be mindful of your own time and consider the return, see how people react. And this is perhaps the most important advice for a successful traditional open source project. So there are various channels of how you support this work. Well, let's assume now that you have a person who worked in the project for a long time. Ultimately, you will want them to become a leader, meaning they become committer status in this traditional language of open source projects, having the commit bit set, change rights, write rights, then you want them to be leaders of the project, and you give them the status and you put them, like yourself, in a management position. And again, it changes the job, what you do. So it should be people who are willing to take responsibility. It's now not surprising, really, but good management practices. Lots of praise, lots of hand-holding, lots of managerial work, much less technical work. But you're willing to do it, or you expect the new committer leader to do it, because by then the loyalty of these people is with the project rather than just fixing the initial problem that brought them to the project. There are all kinds of things you can do. The usual t-shirts you might send around tokens of appreciation. That's what someone may do. Greet them, of course, at a conference, or invite them there, give them speaking slots, etc. And as a project leader, you also have the right to define roles, in some sense you can provide status to people, so use that wisely to have some sort of community career defined that people appreciate, because it expresses, by way of badges or something, expresses the value the project sees in them. So I have one more thing here, which is, what do you do if you actually have problematic people? Now, if you're leading a project, think about whether that's really what you want to do, because it's managerial work, which means you have to deal with people also who may not be fun to deal with. There's a fabulous video by Colin Sussman and Fitzgerald here in the references called How to Deal with Poisonous People. Now, I don't know why they really call them poisonous. It's just difficult people. So how do you deal with that? Because every project sooner or later discovers some of them. And it's a simple process of understanding what makes people difficult, preparing for such situations, then identifying them, and then, of course, handling them. So these difficult people might take away from you the most valuable thing you have, time and attention. That's your most important resource, and might ultimately ruin the project. So the best thing is to simply have a healthy community in which all decisions are documented, because what basically a troll would typically do is question some decision. Why are we using Git rather than Mercurial? Well, a completely random, silly question if you're set on using Git. But someone who will ask that question and then is handled the wrong way might actually eat up a lot of time as someone's trying to be nice and explain these decisions over and over again. Here again comes into play the open communication, public written, complete archived. You just point them to that one summary email where you decided you were going to move to Git rather than Mercurial, or where you're going to use that particular JavaScript framework versus another, etc. So you simply prepare to react speedily if such a person comes along. Now, such a person actually comes along, how do you recognize it? Well, they may not show respect for the project in the sense of they are asking actually really silly questions. You answer, we decided to use Angular for these reasons. Here's the email and the archives that explains why. And if they still start a silly discussion, then it's pretty obvious that this may not be a constructive discourse. They may be too emotional. Collins and Sussman have very funny examples over how people might be talking all caps. I think we've all seen that. All right. And so it's basically how to deal with trolls. Don't feed them. Don't react to them, ignore them if you have to boot them. All right, so then we made it through this whole five stages with a set of best practices each, many more that I didn't even touch upon. And this is how in a traditional open source project you can guide people, or how you'd have to set it up to have someone who just is looking to scratch an itch become possibly a project leader. Again, this covered the left side here. It will change dramatically once you go from traditional open source projects to the foundation-based projects, and you want to advance in a career beyond the leadership of a single component as you become a project management committee member and leader, possibly. That's it from me. Thank you very much for your attention so far. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. Thank you. Please. The question is, maybe your employee contract will prevent you from contributing. I think it's the right of the company to prevent you from contributing. You may not agree. You may want to make the argument that it's in the interest of the company to let you contribute. If you don't get through, well, that's how it is. It's they pay for your time. And so maybe then either you do it in your spare time, or if it's professionally relevant, it really should have been done on company time, maybe something's wrong with the company.
I was wondering, so I remember seeing some paper that they talk about the currency paid to the volunteers. Mm-hmm. Of course, it's not money, but it could be like reputation or respect for the community members. And because you talk about it's really important to recruit new members to the projects. So if there can be some kind of setup or platform to kind of pay that kind of currency to the new members.
Yeah, so currency here really is reputation. So you're talking about this chunk down here, labor economics or career path. And it really means a lot to, can mean a lot to a software developer's career that they have reputation, non-monetary reputation, and what it means to an employer. It goes from the very basic, you're active in an open source project, that means you have a public portfolio of work, which means that a future employer can look at your work and there's a reduced hiring risk in that they can more adequately assess how good you are. I mean, otherwise they need to believe you're good or can test you on the spot. If you can show them continued work in an open source project, they'll check out your code. All the way to you're the leader of a project management committee, you're literally the captain of important components in an industry platform, you have higher visibility in how the architecture of that platform is evolving. To an employer, it means you have this higher visibility that allows you to align the employer's products closer with that platform. You'll be a bit faster, a bit more nimble, a bit more informed than your potential competitors, even though it's all open source, just because you're the person doing the work. So the reputation gets you along these lines, and it pays out by better employability and being more attractive to employers.
Mm-hmm. So thanks a lot. This was very informative, and I learned quite a few things about this. There was one slide which, slide 51, I didn't want to interrupt where you were at that time. So, others may not agree with me, but I currently do have a job. I have people who report to me and I report to some people. And if this is what's being used to, you know, help people, you know, recruit or manage the teams, I have some objections to what's on the left-hand side, mm-hmm. in particular when you're like searching for some words to describe a few of those mm-hmm. things. I have a very philosophical difference with you on that.
Okay, can you be more specific? Or do you want to take this offline?
No, I don't want to take it offline. This is here because it's all about community and it's all about sharing and it's all about being open.
So these are caricatures. These are the extremes. So smart companies have properties like on the right side. I'm not saying that you cannot have an open collaboration inside a company, but the very traditional bureaucratic company with its top-down hierarchy works like this. It's an extreme, and I don't think actually any company can work in this extreme, but this is how they, at least in theory, are set up.
Then may I suggest that instead of saying traditional work, you could say at one extreme.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, fair enough. Thank you. Mm-hmm. There was, yes, please.
So traditionally, the open source software by the name itself seems to attract people with very good analytical skills, mm-hmm. more analytical skills or well trained. Mm-hmm. Are there any positions for soft skills or like well-defined software, which like user interfaces or something where human side is there, it's not advertised, it's not marketed. The open source software projects seem to be a magnet for people on analytical side. Like, fine, that's the project I want to join. Mm-hmm. But for the others, it's like, wow, I don't know if software, open source software is for me. Do you agree?
Somewhat. So I think that it's probably true that for software developers tend to be more analytical and then open source software developers as well. And the examples that you can read, like the Linux kernel mailing list is not a friendly place to be. It has a very rude communication style. It obviously works within its own context. I think very clearly, when you look at these stages, as you see how people move towards more managerial work, the better your social skills, the better the project will be off. I think that the Linux kernel and its particular engineering process and the way how they communicate is a one-off, like Wikipedia is a one-off. It's a very special situation. And you look at other projects like the Apache web server, which is organized very differently. And people actually do have a very different way of communicating. So people like us, but also much more experienced open source developers, have put down their best practice. And they're very clear about don't be rude, be welcoming, etc. Basically, apply soft skills. And so I think that Linux is an unfortunate example in that reputation. Now, I've actually never written an email to the Linux kernel mailing list, so I don't know how it really is, but I read the examples as well. I think, partially already, and certainly in the long term, social skills, as always, will be the more important ones to get team efforts to succeed. Yes, please.
Yeah, I have a comment on that. In terms of the soft skills of the Linux kernel, I'm one Linux kernel maintainer. Mm-hmm. Yes, I agree that, in fact, there is like this huge bad reputation in the soft skills of the Linux kernel community. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, it's not like everybody is like that, mm-hmm. right? And definitely, I agree with all the comments that and the good recommendation that I saw in the presentation in terms of how you deal with the soft skills and how you build this community behind you. And that's actually applied on several different areas mm-hmm. of the Linux kernel.
Yeah.
I mean, with the experience that I had, definitely there are, we can see that the there is people who are willing to welcome volunteers,
yeah.
mm-hmm. And that's why, I mean, the community is actually successful.
Yeah.
But definitely there is also people who are rude and use bad communication skills, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that comes to the other comment that I had, is that yes, it's good for you as a leader to use like good communication skills, but sometimes you as a volunteer needs to be prepared to face with the leaders that are using rude
yeah.
communication, right? And my general recommendation over there is, of course, to stick to technical discussions, mm-hmm. right? And make your stronger arguments on the problem that you need to solve, and that's it. You'll be honored by other people, not only that specific person who may be trolling you, for instance.
So I think you make a valid point that there's, of course, a lot of variety. So thank you for that contribution. I was in a way not so much arguing from the perspective of already the very successful projects where people want to go and are willing to endure maybe not so nice communication, but also I was looking from a project that's trying to build up a community, so that you should spend extra effort and don't push away people who otherwise would be really good. If you can afford to do it, okay, then it becomes less important. Maybe then you will still, if you will, be losing to competing projects, as there always might be some. Some projects like the Linux kernel are so explicitly out there and without real competition that of course, they have their own rules.
Mm-hmm.
And just an extra
yeah.
comment. I mean, the Linux kernel might be on this specific slide,
mm-hmm.
the extreme of the left of the right side, right?
Yeah.
Where you would find like a case where you actually see some characteristics of the left.
All right. Thank you. Yes, please.
kind of going in the opposite direction. Have you looked at the more general aspects of crowdsourcing? And you know, a lot of what you talked about reminds me of a talk by Will Wright talking about The Sims and how they built a community for building objects within, you know, that game, and or like Wikipedia. You know, how would you relate what you have there to those communities at large?
Well, so these open collaboration principles here, whether we chose the right words, I don't know, but we actually believe open collaboration as defined here applies broadly, not just to open source software, but to Wikipedia, also to Wikipedia as well, and how you can work in some wikis, how the open educational resources community goes about its work, etc. We even have a conference called OpenSim, which is on trying to bring together all these different disciplines which have some of these openness characteristics that vary in detail, but that all speak to these issues. So I think actually there's a lot of overlap and similarity here in how to have an effective collaboration, that form of open collaboration, and that it's not at all restricted to software.
But are you doing anything with the computer supported cooperative work conference going on?
So right now in San Francisco, there's actually an ACM conference, one of the bigger ones, the CSCW conference. I'm a regular there, but tonight I'm down here.
Thank you.
Yes, please.
Yeah, I was just wondering, what's the role of the blockchain maybe in eventually giving credit to each person, maybe giving some sort of a reward? So there's a new application called colony.io, which applies the concept of the blockchain.
Okay. I'm not aware of that. There are various forms of how this reputation can be formalized. Most of the time, it's really just informal and it's kind of in the social graph, but not machine processable. On a variety of forges, you could give people kudos. OpenHub, the former Olo, you can give people kudos for their involvement. So there's some sort of crowdsourced contribution. Now these are, if you will, commercial projects. I'm not aware of any ways or attempts to use blockchain technology to do that. Could be interesting to make it independent of any particular website.
So do these involve profit for the contributors?
No, none of these. So these are all metrics websites. So OpenHub is not really making money for Black Duck software, but it's kind of being cross-subsidized, I guess. But there's no payback to the developers. It's not about funding developers.
One last question. Do you think if there is payment for the contributors, it would affect the way, the dynamics of the of this mechanism that you just...
Well, there are all kinds of websites, or at least you know, there are various attempts so that people can literally finance the development of some features that could pay developers. I think in the general case, you just find an employer and you want to work on an economically valuable open source project, and then there will be plenty of employers who will want you to work on that. I don't see the cottage industry model of like you have independent income somehow from the crowd for your work. I'm not aware of how this is currently working well somewhere. Yes, please.
Do you perceive a difference in the open source forges that are used by people in Europe versus the other parts of the world?
No, I didn't really don't think there's certainly the Western world. There are not any major differences here. So it's the usual suspects. It's it used to be GeForge and Redmine as open source software that you could install. Now there's increasingly GitLab being used, or people use GitHub Enterprise inside companies or on github.com itself. I wouldn't see any particular cultural or social aspects that make one go to one forge or another. What we do notice is that there are differences in how different cultures participate in open source as a whole, but that's the participation in open source, and I don't think that's tied to the tools as much as it is a cultural thing on what it means to, say, expose yourself. I mean, as you contribute to open source, in some sense you become vulnerable. It's great if you do good work and an employer can look at that, but if you do shoddy work and you get lots of bug reports filed against you, well, that's also very visible and out there for eternity. So some fear that more, so some see the advantages and the prospects, and others see the downside more. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. Yes, please.
Under what, which sort of environments or which sort of projects does the traditional or the open collaboration tend to work better?
Mm-hmm. Yes, so the question is in this, these two extremes where I'm trying to make up this spectrum of two forms of collaboration, is it context dependent, where one works better than the other? Meaning, is this the classic Weber organization, the bureaucracy, and this is, well, has been called the bazaar with no hierarchy at all? I honestly believe that the reality is a hybrid, that you want both. You cannot have a large organization without some top-down management, but you clearly do not want to stifle creativity and fluidity and innovation by fully structuring it. So the big, one of my main work topics these days is actually introducing into companies which are somewhat structured along these hierarchical lines, these open collaboration principles within the company. So not to engage with open source projects, but just within the company, learn to work across their silos in an open collaborative way. So rather than having that hierarchy breakdown, you're opening it up from the bottom, and it's as basic as make all the software that's being developed visible, allow developers to communicate across it, about it, and thereby see all the redundancy, recognize how pointless the redundancy is, that rather than doing the same component six times, it would be much better to do the component once in higher quality. This is an important work topic for me right now. There's lots and lots of company interest. In fact, this week that I'm in the Valley here, two of my talks are just about this effect called inner source. So it's not open source, it's inner source, the idea that you more broadly source across the company. So I think, I don't really know about contexts where each of these works particularly well. I think you will always want to combine them in reality.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. Thanks everyone, and of course, thanks to Symantec.